Hi all, in this lecture we'll study some motivating examples for the course on concentration inequality, and we will end with some observations as to what the course will contain and provide a high level overview of the organization and content of the course. So let's start with a very basic motivating question. Okay, so suppose you toss a fair coin independently 10,000 times. How many heads will you see? Okay. So at a first cut, you may be tempted to answer that you expect to see 5,000 heads. That is correct. You indeed expect to see on an average 5,000 heads. But then there are several levels at which this question can be answered. So let's first begin by asking the question, what is the reasoning behind 5,000? Okay, so why is this? This is based on the heuristic that as you toss more and more times, the number of heads observed should essentially become closer and closer to the expected value or the average number of heads from tossing a single coin. Okay, so this is called the law of large numbers. Okay, so one can actually represent mathematically the number of heads that you will actually get as the sum x1 plus x2 all the way up to x1x 10,000, okay, where each random variable xi is 0 or 1 with probability half, okay, and these are independent. Okay, so what is this law of large numbers? So standard probability theory tells you that there is, let's say, this weak law of large numbers, which basically states that if x1, x2 and so on up to xn are independent and identically distributed random variables, so IID will always be used to mean independent and identically distributed . So if the xi are IID random variables with, let's say, finite mean and variance, then for any tolerance epsilon, we have that the probability that the sample mean of these xi's converges to the expected value of any one of them. Recall that they're all identically distributed anyway. So the probability that the sample mean deviates from the true expectation by a quantity more than epsilon tends to zero as more and more random variables are added to the mix, okay, so as n increases. But however, this is only an asymptotic result, okay, so note that there is a limit here. So it's not a priori easy to say at what n and how small this probability becomes, okay, so at what n this probability starts becoming very small is not indicated by this result, and that's the reason it's called an asymptotic result, okay. So even so, there is another kind of looseness with this law of large numbers in trying to answer this question, which is the fact that even if n is large, let's say n is large enough such that the probability above has become exactly zero. Okay, so let's say that you've made n so large as to drive this probability to approximately zero. Okay, what we have from this statement is that you can fix any epsilon. Okay, so you can fix fix an epsilon, and this will tell you that 1 over n summation I xi minus ex1, okay, is less than equal to epsilon. Okay, so at a very first order level of approximation, you will have that this quantity is less than equal to epsilon. So in other words, this means that the total number of heads, which is the sum ixi, is basically within n times expected value of x1, which is half, okay, minus epsilon n, and the upper end of this interval is n by 2 plus epsilon n. Okay, so this means that the amount of approximation in reporting or estimating the sum xi or the number of heads is basically an order n amount. Okay, so the order n amount is basically this epsilon n here. Okay, So this specifies the number of heads up to an error of order n, even if you assume that it is not asymptotic. Okay, in some strange way, suppose it were non-asymptotic, you would still get an order n error here. Okay. The second type of answer that you can give to this question is by using something more refined. Okay, so you can probably, for instance, say the following. You can say that the number of heads is going to be, let's say, 5,000, which is the mean value, which is what we estimated in the first answer, plus or minus a certain range. In this case, this is the square root of the number of times you're tossing this coin, that is 10,000, okay, into the variance of each toss, okay, which happens to be 1 over 4. And there is this function Q inverse of 0.005. So the answer here is that the number of heads is 5,000 plus or minus this number here, this deviation, with a probability, let's say, at least 0.99. okay, so with 99% probability, the number of heads is bound to be within this range. Okay, so what is Q here? If you haven't seen this before, Q is just the Gaussian tail probability function, the Gaussian cumulative complementary cumulative distribution function. Okay, so Q is the Gaussian CCDF, and Q inverse is its inverse, okay, inverse function. So Q of any number is the probability that a standard normal Gaussian random variable is greater than or equal to that number, and Q inverse of any number is the inverse of the Q function. Okay, so this is clearly a more refined answer. So this 5,000 plus minus something is clearly a more refined answer, which is actually based on what is called the central limit theorem, which is another asymptotic result. So what is the central limit theorem here? So one version of the central limit theorem, which is a very famous result in probability, is as follows. So if x1 through xn are IID with bounded mean and variance, let's say, then if you take the quantity summation of xi, which is the number of heads in our case, and center it by its mean, which is n by 2 here, okay, and divide this deviation by a factor square root of n, then as n increases, this quantity, this random variable, converges in distribution to a standard normal random variable, to a normal random variable with mean 0 and variance equal to the variance of x1, okay, each of these random variables. Okay, so using this, one can try to also estimate or give some estimates of deviations. But again, this is an asymptotic result, because you see there is a limit here. Okay, because of the limit here, this is again an asymptotic result, prompting questions like, you know, is 1,000 equal to infinity? Okay, so in some sense, this is 10,000. So is 10,000 equal to infinity? Is the number of heads that we have tossed, is the number of coins that we have tossed sufficient to guarantee that the statement of the central limit theorem kicks in or not? Okay, so this is not explicitly indicated by the theorem. Okay, so we have come this far. Okay, and this gives somewhat sharper estimates than the answer number one. One can hope to fix the fact that this is an asymptotic result by using what is called Berry-Essene correction. Okay, so Berry-Essene correction is essentially a fix to make the standard central limit theorem non-asymptotic. Okay, so one version of a Berry-Essene type correction is as follows. If all these random variables are IID with a finite expectation, let's assume that they are zero mean, finite variance and finite third moment, then there is some constant such that the following happens. For any number of tosses, note that this is non-asymptotic. Okay, so at any finite n and any value of deviation epsilon, the probability that the scaled number of heads, okay, essentially scaled by 1 over square root n, is less than a certain number. So in reality, what would you expect this to be? If the central limit theorem were perfect, you would expect this to be the cumulative distribution function of a standard normal, which is 1 minus Q of epsilon. And so the Berry-Essene correction basically tells you that these two quantities differ by a quantity which is no more than constant by square root n. Okay, so the larger now is the number of heads you toss, the tail probability of the scaled sum versus the benchmark, which is the corresponding tail probability for a standard Gaussian, differs only by a vanishing quantity that goes particularly as a constant by square root n. Okay, so you can use this to correct your estimate for number of heads a little better. And this is widely used in probability theory. But however, we'll see that more generic and simpler to understand techniques also give us similar answers. Okay, so that's sort of going to be the main punchline of this course. You don't need to study specifically what happens with Gaussian random variables, or you don't need to try to match things with Gaussian random variables, but you can develop generic techniques. So another comment in passing is that there is another asymptotic regime different than the central limit theorem regime, which is called large deviations. So recall that the characteristic feature of the central limit theorem is that the sum of n terms is being divided by something like square root of n. Okay, in the large deviations regime, it's more like dividing the sum by the total number of summands itself. So it's the sample mean regime. It studies the fluctuation of the sample mean. So here's a typical large deviation statement specialized to our case of independent coins being tossed. So pick your favorite interval A. Okay, let A be an interval in R. Okay, so let's say A is of the form A comma B. Okay, so it's a set of all real numbers between A and B. The intervals can either be open or closed. It doesn't matter really for this example. What it says is that if you take the probability that the sample mean of n coin tosses, the average proportion, the proportion of heads in those tosses belongs to this interval A. If you take the probability that this proportion belongs to A, take the log of that probability and divide by 1 over n with a minus sign. Okay, so that's going to be a non-negative number finally. As n becomes larger and larger, this quantity tends to a very specific limit, which is the which can be expressed as the solution to another variational problem, the minimum of a certain function I on that interval A. Okay, so think of this function I called a rate function, defined on the entire real line. And if you are interested in the probability of this sample mean falling in any interval for a large enough value of n, all you have to do is go to that interval and solve the minimization of I over that interval, and you will basically get this exponent. Okay, so what this means in other words is that if you take A as the interval x to infinity, let's say, where x is larger than half. Okay, so we need x to be larger than the expected value, which is half in this case, of each random variable. Then what happens is something nice. For large enough n, the probability that summation xi larger than a number n times x approximately falls off exponentially in n, with the constant in the exponent being given by this the rate function here, okay, at x. So this is just by manipulating the general large deviations inequality above. So the general large deviations limiting result tells you that minus 1 over n log of this probability is roughly going to be the infimum of x in A of I of x. Okay, and it turns out that you can show that I of x must be a convex function. And it always is non-decreasing to the right of the expected value. So the minimum of I of x, the minimum of the function I in the interval x to infinity, where x is to the right of the actual mean, mean of x1, which is half, that answer must be I of x itself. So you basically get a slightly stronger, in some sense, statement of the weak law of large numbers, in the sense that you get this decay rate, exact decay rate of the probability of deviating from the sample mean. Okay, and this is an exponentially decaying rate. However, this is still asymptotic, so there is no indication provided of at what n this limit really becomes close. Okay? So, leaving this aside, let us proceed to something which is actually going to be the main motivation for undertaking the study of concentration inequalities. It is the fact that one can actually get rather concrete non-asymptotic answers using things simple inequalities or statements like Markov's and Chebyshev's inequality. Okay, so for instance, we can answer question one. Okay, which is the question of how many heads do you expect to see in 10,000 tosses by just using what is called Chebyshev's inequality. Okay, so Chebyshev's inequality says that for a random variable x, let's say with finite mean, for any value of delta greater than 0, typically delta is a probability number between 0 and 1, we have that the probability of x minus its expectation deviating from this number, which is square root of variance x over delta, is no more than delta. Okay, so the smaller delta, the larger the bound on x minus ex. Okay, so this just means if you turn it on its head, that with probability at least 1 minus delta, the quantity x minus expected value of x is always less than square root variance x divided by delta. Okay, so this gives you a high probability guarantee on x deviating from its own mean. Okay, this is one of the most, arguably one of the simplest concentration inequalities. And if you now specialize this to x being the sum of the first n coin tosses, okay, where each xi is either 0 or 1, probability half independently, the expected value of x simply becomes n times the expected value of every coin toss, which is n by 2. Okay, so this is n by 2. Okay, likewise, the variance of x, which is the sum of n independent random variables, you can also show that this is equal to n times, this is the sum of variances really. So the sum, the variance of a sum of independent random variables is just the sum of the individual variances. And let us say you set delta equal to 0.01 and apply Chebyshev's inequality to this setting. You'll basically get that with probability at least 0.99, which is 1 minus delta, the number of heads is this quantity, which is 5000 plus minus 2500 by 0.01 inside the square root. Okay, and this evaluates to 500. Okay, so you get at least a concrete answer, which is guaranteed to be correct with probability at least 99% if you toss exactly 10,000 coins. Okay, so compare this with let's take a moment to compare this with the CLT inspired answer, the central limit theorem guided answer, which gave us something similar. But by making sort of the hand-wavy approximation that 10,000 is close to infinity. Okay, so what did answer 2 give you? Maybe it's time to go back and look at answer 2. So answer 2 basically gave you 5,000 plus minus square root of 2,500. Okay, which is 50 times a Q inverse of 0.005. Okay, so what is Q inverse 0.005? If you actually look a little carefully at the Q inverse function, it's not hard to see that show that Q inverse of a very small number is approximately square root of log of inverse of that number. Okay, so for delta very, very small, Q inverse of delta by 2 is roughly square root of log of 1 over delta by 2, which is square root of log of 2 over delta. So the CLT gives us an estimate for the summation I equal to 1 to n xi, which is a total number of heads, of n times expected value x1, which is the expected value of the sum, plus minus square root of n times variance of x1. That's exactly the central limit theorem correction. Okay, you have to divide by sigma into square root n, where sigma is the standard deviation of each random variable. Okay, into a square root of log 2 by delta. Okay, so that square root of 2 log by delta is the approximation being used here to Q inverse delta by 2. Okay, with probability at least 1 minus delta. So note that this number here, okay, the square root of n into variance, which is 50 in this case, is being multiplied with square root of log 2 by delta. Whereas in contrast, the finite sample Chebyshev inequality above, okay, gave us a valid inequality for any finite n and for any delta, any probability delta, of order n times expected value x1 plus square root n times variance x1 into square root 1 by delta. Okay, the square root 1 by delta is simply the square root 1 by delta here. Okay, so that's the square root 1 by delta. Okay, with probability at least 1 minus delta. So there's this sort of loosening here, in that the order of deviation here that Chebyshev gives you is square root 1 over delta as opposed to square root log of 1 by delta. Okay, so this is a arguably a big factor improvement in the CLT, which is at a different level weaker because of being asymptotic. But there's nothing to despair here. In fact, we will see that there is often a stronger method called the Chernoff bound compared to the Chebyshev bound that can be used instead of Chebyshev to show in a non-asymptotic fashion for finite samples n that you can get the same order of magnitude as what CLT gives you. Okay, so you'll basically get with x being the sum of n coin tosses, you'll basically get the actual expected mean plus minus some constant times the square root of n times variance x1 into log of 1 by delta inside the square root. Okay, so you get a big improvement of going from 1 over delta to log 1 over delta. Okay, so that's where sort of Chernoff really matters. It gives you in some sense an exponential rate of decay of the probability of the sample mean deviating, which if inverted gives you a logarithmic dependence on the reciprocal of the target failure probability. So this course is basically going to be presenting a lot of variations on this theme for both independent as well as non-independent random variables. And there are going to be a bunch of such derived inequalities which build upon basic Chebyshev or Chernoff methods. Okay, so at the heart of all these methods is going to be what is called the Chernoff-Kramer bound or the Chernoff-Kramer technique, which if used or instantiated appropriately, gives very useful inequalities such as Hoeffding's inequality, widely used in areas like learning theory and statistical learning theory. It gives inequalities like Bennett's inequality and Bernstein's inequality, which is often used as a tighter version of Hoeffding's inequality. Okay, so with this, let's move to the second motivating example. The second motivating example is the following question, which is often called the coupon collector problem. So let's say every day you go and buy an ice cream cone, and hidden within it, there is one coupon. Every ice cream cone contains one coupon of a uniformly random color. Okay, so let's say there are k total colors of which coupons are made, and each time every ice cream that you buy contains one randomly colored coupon, okay, hidden inside it, and you start collecting these coupons. Now, how many ice creams do you need to eat before you can collect all k colored coupons? Okay, so this is the well-known coupon collector problem. And just to formalize this again, like we did with the coin tossing problem, so let's denote xi as the color of the ith coupon, okay, that you collected. Okay, so this is a clearly, let's index all the colors by 1, 2, 3 up to k. Let's assume there are k colors. And so this is clearly a number between 1 to k. Okay, so this bracket k notation basically denotes the set of integers 1, 2, 3 up to k. Okay, so in addition, let's introduce this notation f of x1, x2 up to xn. So suppose you've eaten n ice creams and you have n coupons in your hand. F will look at all these x1, x2 up to xn, the colors of all these coupons, and it will return the number of distinctly colored coupons among this set. Okay, so let F be the number of distinctly colored coupons among the coupon colors x1 through xn. Okay. So we want, so what is the coupon collector problem? It basically asks you to find with high probability. So we want an integer n such that if you've collected n coupons, then the probability that the number of distinct colored coupons that you've collected equals the full set of colors k, okay, with high probability. So this probability should be large, or in other words, the probability that f of x1 through xn strictly less than k, you've not made all colors, is quite small. Okay, so at what value of n relative to k, okay, do such probabilities start appearing very large or very small respectively? Okay, so that's the coupon collector problem. I'm not going to get into the basics or the details of this problem. It turns out that you can easily get the expected value of the number of the first time n at which you collect all k coupons. Okay, that happens to be in fact k log k. Let's get into the details of this later in the course if possible. Okay, so this is just a motivating example to illustrate that you would like to control probabilities of this form, okay, where x1 up to xn are in this case independent random variables. They are independent colors of coupons that you buy each day. But the f function is something that looks very different than, let's say, the sum or the sample mean of x1 through xn. Okay, so it counts something very discrete. It counts the number of distinct colors. So you want to control the fluctuation of functions like f rather than functions that look like simple sums or averages. Okay, so this is the point to bear in mind from this motivating question. The last motivating question is something that occurs in areas of computer science, computational linguistics, sometimes in bioinformatics and word processing and so on. It's the problem of the longest common subsequence. So this just says that if you picked if you made two IID sequences, x1 through xn and y1 through yn, okay, so each of the xi's is independent, each of the yi's is independent from the other random variables here. What's the length of the longest common subsequence between these two? Okay, so what is the longest common subsequence defined as? I'll just describe that using an example. Suppose x1, so suppose x1n is the sequence of let's say six 0 or 1 letters, so 0 1 0 1 1 0, and let's say x2 y1n is another binary string, 1 0 0 0 1 0. Okay, the longest common subsequence, the length of a longest common subsequence, a longest common subsequence, it need not be unique always. So for instance, one common subsequence which occurs in both is 1 0 1 0. Similarly, you can see the same pattern here, 1 0 1 0. Okay, so there can be any arbitrary number of symbols in between this common subsequence in when it occurs in both of these strings, but as long as you find the same order of the subsequence in both, you call it a longest common subsequence. In this case, the length of this common subsequence turns out to be 4, which is also the length of the largest common subsequence. So length of the longest common subsequence in this case is 4. Okay, so this is some random number if all these strings are chosen randomly. Okay, so what's the length of a longest common subsequence, and what can you say about the properties of such a random variable? Okay, does it concentrate, does it sort of deviate too much from, let's say, its central value, let's say its mean or its median, and if so, then by what amount? How does it concentrate as a function of n, maybe the alphabet size and so on. Okay, so in fact, this course motivates the fact that to answer questions such as studying the fluctuations of the length of the longest common subsequence, or let's say the number of coupons collected in intrays, or even the simple question of bounding averages or sums of random variables, we will find it useful to extend concentration of measure bounds to the following two situations. One is when you have a quantity that depends on independently distributed random variables x1 through xn, which need not be identically distributed, so they may all have different distributions. The more interesting and involved case is when you have to control the fluctuations of a general function f of x1 through xn, where x1 through xn are independent random variables. Okay, instead of, let's say, the very simple sum that we have already studied, which is f equal to the sum of all these random variables. So you may have very complicated nonlinear functions f of a bunch of random variables x1 through xn, and you may be requiring to bound the fluctuations of f of x1 through xn, which is just another random variable depending through f on these random variables, in terms of some central quantity, some central measure like its expectation or its mean. Okay. So this is where this is what the course hopefully will enable you to do, and it will show you a spectrum of methods and techniques to try and break down the analysis of such the fluctuations of such functions. So in this regard, it's very important to keep in mind a very general principle that one of the great mathematicians of our era, Michel Talleyrand, introduced. So the insight that he obtained is that a random variable that depends smoothly on a large number of independent random variables satisfies Chernoff type concentration bounds. Okay, so by smoothly is used here as a vague term, but it can be made precise. But the point is that smoothly here is used in the sense that it's stable with respect to small perturbations of its constituent random variables. Okay, so it doesn't change. With small changes in its constituent random variables. Okay, so this is the general principle that we will actually seek to elucidate and bring out for the entire duration of this course. And you will see this phenomenon happen repeatedly, irrespective of whatever techniques we use to analyze the behavior of a function of random variables, that stability brings with it some kind of stability of the function overall, brings with it a stability of the of its fluctuations. So just as a broad outline, I'd like to present what kinds of just a roadmap of what kinds of techniques one could expect to see in this course as it moves through the semester. So at the simplest level, we will have simple Chernoff type concentration inequalities that we will start out with. Okay, so Chernoff type bounds that we will build in some detail. Okay, so this is one aspect of the concentration inequalities course. Moving on from here, we will study broadly a technique called tensorization. Okay. Okay, tensorization techniques have to do with how you break down a complicated dependence of, let's say, one random variable on a bunch of others into simple manageable forms like sums. Okay, the sum is probably the simplest way of breaking down an aggregate quantity into its constituents. And we will study this in an abstract level in the form of what are called martingale bounds, then a method called the Ephronstein technique, or the Ephronstein inequality or family of inequalities, and finally conclude with what is called the entropy method. Okay, so this is going to be for a large part the second portion of the course. Moving on, we will also try to study the relation of what are called isoperimetric inequalities. Which often arise in geometry and measure theory, how they connect to or how they can be useful in giving concentration inequalities. So isoperimetric inequalities are an entire area that generalizes the common isoperimetric geometric inequalities that we've been used to since high school. So things like of all 2D shapes with a given area, the one with the minimum circumference is the circle, the 2D circle. Or conversely, of all given 2D shapes with a given perimeter, the one with the largest area is the circle. So these are isoperimetric inequalities of a very simple form. But there are more general isoperimetric inequalities for measures over spaces that in fact directly give us concentration inequalities. And we will also finally see what is called the transportation method. Okay, that relies on what are called transportation inequalities, which when used cleverly give you concentration inequalities to control fluctuations of random variables. Okay, along with this, so this is in some sense going to be the core material of this course. We will also hope to add, time permitting, things like Talagrand's convex distance inequality. Which is a very celebrated inequality that in one sense tightens inequalities derived from the Chernoff method or Martingale methods by using very different methods, by using a very different approach. Okay. Just a word about applications. We will, time permitting again. Time permitting, we hope to illustrate some of these concentration inequalities that we will uncover throughout the course in the form of applications to, let's say, physically relevant problems. So there's a long list of applications to which you can apply concentration inequalities. Some of these which we hope to touch upon are things like the Johnson-Lindenstrauss lemma. Okay, so this phenomenon is at the heart of many dimensionality reduction techniques in statistics and machine learning and big data. Something called hypercontractivity. The analysis of the lasso algorithm, which is an estimation technique, and its performance. Turns out that some very non-trivial concentration inequalities help you understand its performance well. So lasso. Then there is the application to deriving what is called a blowing up lemma, or blowing up lemmas, in which are useful in the context of information and coding theory. Finally, there are also resource allocation problems in stochastic settings that benefit a lot from specialized concentration inequalities. So these are, let's say, scheduling problems like bin packing, standard coupon collecting, longest common subsequences. Another name for coupon collecting is what is called the birthday paradox, and so on and so forth. Okay, so time permitting, we'll try to touch upon some or probably all of these applications. The last part of this lecture is something probably more fun and hands-on. I'd like to show you some actual computer simulations of random quantities, like what we've seen before, like sums, averages, the time to collect coupons, k coupons, even the longest common subsequence, and show numerically that these quantities actually concentrate. Okay, so these quantities actually concentrate very tightly in practice. And to some extent, this course is trying to offer you the theoretical framework to try to make sense of these phenomena that are often observed in practical life. I'm now going to show you some examples, numerical examples,
of random variables that actually concentrate despite being complicated functions of other independent and simpler random variables. So let's start in MATLAB by trying to show how the sample mean of a bunch of IID random variables concentrates. So I've written this function here, which basically just takes every time it's called, it just samples n independent Bernoulli half random variables, let's say representing the independent coin tosses that we saw in our first example today, and just returns their mean. Okay, so this mean, their sample mean is also an independent random variable. So each time this function is called, it basically returns 1 over n summation of xi, where the xi are drawn IID Bernoulli half. Okay. So what I've written at the top level is a wrapper function called plot sample distribution that basically just takes 1,000 samples, independent samples of, let's say, this sample mean sampler, okay, and then just plots a histogram of the samples returned. Okay, so it will plot essentially the empirical distribution or variation of all these 1,000 sample means, okay, that are independently chosen in each experiment. So let's go ahead, make a new figure and plot the sample distribution for the sample mean of IID random variables, where n is set to be, let us say, 10. Okay, so 10 random variables are going to be sampled, and their means are going to be plotted for 1,000 separate experiments. Okay, so this is what happens. Okay, so you see this histogram. That's basically between the values are on the x-axis between 0 and 1. And as expected, the peak is around 0.5. Okay, so a large number of these sample means fall near in the neighborhood of 0.5. Let's now increase the number of coin tosses from n equal to 10 to, let's say, n equal to 100, and then see what happens. So I'm just going to increment the number of samples taken to compute each sample mean from 10 to 100. Okay, and so this is what happens. You can see that it's again distributed close to 0.5, but then much better concentrated. So if you see these plots side by side, the first one and the second one, you'll see what I mean here. Okay. So going from 10 coin tosses to 100 coin tosses has already made the sample mean concentrate somewhat. Let's do one last experiment where we take 1,000 coin tosses and plot sample means for these 1,000 coin tosses in 1,000 distinct independent experiments. Okay, so this is what happens. You can see that there is a very sharp concentration. And if I just get all these figures together, you can see that this concentration of measure phenomenon is actually happening. So there's most of the probability very, very close to 0.5. Okay, if you toss more and more number of coins. So let's move on to a slightly more complicated example, which is also what we saw in the lecture. And this is basically going to be the time taken to collect. This is a random variable representing the time taken to collect n different coupons. Okay, so each time this sub function, which is coupon collector time, is called, what it does is it simulates a random experiment where there are n different coupons. Okay, you can think of these as n different colors of coupons. In each time, it basically collects a uniformly random coupon labeled anywhere from 1 through n. And it basically measures the first time at which you collect all n coupons. Okay, so this is the time at which you're happy to have collected all the colors. And for technical reasons, we are going to scale this first time at which you collect all n coupons by the number n log n. Okay. N log n in some sense is used because we know that the expected time to collect all the expected first time at which you collect all the n coupons is of order n log n, actually. Okay. So it's reasonable to scale by this factor. Okay. So let's go ahead and see what happens when I'm going to change to plotting the coupon collector time when, let's say, the first time at which you collect coupons of colors between 1 to 10. Okay, and so this is what happens. You basically collect coupons at times roughly spread out from 0 to 2 times n log n, where n is 10. Okay, so roughly 2 to 20. And this is the probability distribution of how likely it is that you collect the coupon at a given time on the x-axis. So let's bump it up to collecting coupons of 100 different types. Okay. And so this is what happens. You can see that it started to concentrate a little bit. If you see this in context, this is evident. Okay. Let's maybe see what happens when you try to collect. You look for the first time, the random time at which you collect 1,000 different coupons. Okay. And so you can see that this is already concentrated. Okay. And so that's what's happening. Okay, maybe let's do one more while we're at it. So 10,000 coupons. Just to show you the sequential progression. Okay, so on the top right is 10, then there's 100, then there's 1,000, and then there's 10,000. Okay, so you can see that there is a concentration of probability phenomenon happening, and you can actually use the techniques that we'll go through in the course, some of these techniques, to try and actually get a theoretical explanation for this phenomenon. Okay, so let's move on to our third numerical example, which is also something we saw in the lecture, which is the problem of the length of the longest common subsequence. Okay, so what's happening here is that each time this experiment is run, what it does is the following. It takes two strings of a specified length n, where each element of each string is drawn uniformly at random from an alphabet of size k. Okay, so if k is 2, each is a binary string. If k is equal to 3, then each of these n length strings is a ternary string, and so on. Okay. So generate two random strings and then basically do an operation to compute the length of a longest common subsequence between these two length n strings. And so that's what it's going to return. Okay, so we are going to directly histogram or plot the empirical distribution of 1,000 independent experiments of finding the length of the longest common substring or subsequence. Okay. So recall that the subsequence need not occur contiguously in both of these strings. That's by the definition of the longest common sequence problem. So let's go ahead and do the same histogramming exercise for the length of the longest common substring. Let's say we generate strings of length 10, let's say with a quaternary alphabet. So each symbol can be four letters, okay, and these are n length strings. Okay, so four letters. See, each symbol can either be one of four letters, just as let's say you have in the DNA sequence or the RNA sequence. So this is the histogram for the longest common subsequence between two length 10 strings. Okay, it's obviously a number between 0 and 10. So and it's concentrated somewhere, somewhat concentrated somewhere around 5 or 6. Let's bump this up to finding the length of the longest common substring between two length 100 strings. Okay, and you can already see that there's a sharp concentration. So let me put these side by side so that you can compare these plots. Okay, so there's some fairly sharp concentration occurring at around length 60 or 65. I don't know if this will work for length equal to, let's try length equal to, let's say 500, assuming it doesn't take too long. So we need to let the sampling run for some time. Okay, there it is, much more concentrated. Okay, so you can see that there's barely a difference going from 100 to 500, but nevertheless, all the probability has basically moved into the central bin. Okay, if you have a more powerful computer, maybe you could try more fancier experiments. Let's see, I had one more here to present, which is again a very interesting random quantity that occurs in all aspects of engineering and random structures, which is the largest eigenvalue of a random matrix. Okay, so here's a specific example where the specific experiment run each time is to return a random variable, which is the largest eigenvalue of a symmetric randomly generated square matrix of size n. So it's an n by n symmetric square matrix, which is generated as follows. So the lower triangle is populated independently with standard normal entries, okay, and those entries are basically mirrored on the upper triangular part, so that you get a symmetric random matrix. And for technical reasons, we are also going to divide this largest eigenvalue of this n by n matrix by the quantity square root n, and then plot the histogram of this random quantity. Okay, the largest eigenvalue of a random matrix. Okay, so in this case, this is also connected to the norm. The largest eigenvalue of this matrix is a measure of its size. Okay, so it's a single scalar measure of how large this matrix is, this random matrix is. Okay, and we would like to study the distribution of this quantity and whether it concentrates well. So let's go ahead and run our sampler and histogramming routine, wrapper routine for the eigenvalue example. So we'll pass it a matrix size of, let's say, 10. So this is what happens. So for a 10 by 10 matrix generated randomly according to the description I gave you, this is what happens to the normalized maximum eigenvalue, normalized by square root n. If we run this for matrices of size 100, we need to give it some time to compute and sample. So it's already looking like it's concentrating fast. Okay, so you can see that there's a distinct pushing towards of all the probability mass towards sort of central value, and this is going to get even more concentrated and peaky as the size of the square matrix increases. Okay, so there are many such examples. And hopefully the techniques that we will study in this course on concentration inequalities will give you a basis to reason about why these phenomena occur and when you should expect such concentration phenomena to occur in problems that you may be studying. Thank you.